So, as discussed in this session, we'll be like discussing about what is the decision tree and how we can avoid overfitting in a decision tree, and then how we can like, you know, find a trade-off in balancing your bias and variance. And then we'll be like, you know, discussing about a little of ensembling methods, and then we will be like discussing about very important techniques and how to split your tree nodes, decision trees. Okay, so we'll be like, you know, discussing majority of decision tree concepts. So let's get into this. So as you all know, decision trees is a supervised algorithm. Okay, so I believe you already know, like, you know, machine learning has different types of learning algorithms, like supervised, unsupervised, and, you know, semi-supervised, and we have deep learning. So yes, so this decision trees belongs to the cluster of supervised learning algorithm, and it works both for regression and classification problems. So though people majorly use decision trees, random forest, and boosting algorithms for classification, but you can use that for regression as well. Okay, so here decision trees, it helps to, like, you know, split your data into two or more clusters, but you'll be having a homogeneous clusters at the end. Okay, so that's the major aim of decision tree, so that you'll be able to, like, you know, predict your future variables. Okay, as you can see in the diagram here, so you have a root node, which is your complete data, and then you'll be like splitting data based on different you know, criteria. So you'll be have to take a decision on what criteria that we'll be like, you know, splitting, and your tree, and then it goes on your final, you know, node where you can't split more is the terminal node, whereas where you have to take a decision, it is called as a decision node. Okay, so we'll be having a regression tree as well as a classification tree. So when you have a dependent variable which is very continuous in nature, you call that as a regression tree. When your dependent variable is categorical, you call that as a classification tree. So you have you can call that as a different types of trees. So this root node is a parent node. Okay, and you can call that your decision nodes as internal nodes, and your terminal nodes as leaf node. Okay, these are the, like, you know, terms which are like used interchangeably. So you can call that a root node as a parent node, decision node as a internal node, and your terminal node as a leaf node. Okay, so here when you, like, you know, split your root node or any of your decision node into two or more sub nodes, you can call that as a children node as well, parent node and the children node. Okay, so when you are able to remove a terminal node from your decision node, you can call that as a you know, pruning. Okay, so this is this cluster is, you can call that as a branch or a subtree. Okay, a subsection of the entire tree is called as a branch or a subtree. So we're just, like, you know, trying to discuss about the terminologies which are associated with this decision trees algorithm. Okay, so, and we'll be, like, discussing about ensemble learning as well, which is, like, very, very popular recently, and I mean, the last few years, and it's actually kind of getting you good rankers in the Kaggle, and it is it helps a lot of algorithms to perform better, like random forest, gradient boosting, XGBoost. Okay. Okay. I think we discussed this already. So that, like, you know, two type of decision trees, a regression tree or a classification tree. Otherwise, you can call it as continuous variable decision tree or a categorical variable decision tree. So when your decision tree is, like, you know, continuous, if with their target variable, you can call that as a regression tree or a continuous variable tree. And if it is categorical, you can call it as a classification tree or a categorical variable decision tree. Okay, so here decision trees with regression, they use mean for prediction or any other average methods like weighted average, things like that. But whereas in categorical trees, they use mode. Okay, so an example for categorical trees would be, like, you know, whether we are trying to predict whether the student will be is willing to play cricket or not. Okay, And for regression trees, we are trying to predict the premium for any insurance company. Okay. Okay, so now we are trying to understand how a decision tree based algorithm is like, you know, splitting your data. Actually, this is a very, very important thing in all the tree algorithms. Okay, so imagine you have a data of 30 students, and if you're trying to split the data based on whether they can able to like play cricket or not. Okay, I'm sorry. So we have a students of 30 in our data. Among those students, 15 students can like, you know, play cricket. So 50% of the students can play cricket. So we are trying to predict who can predict based on the gender, height, and the class they are in. Okay, because these are the variables available. So when you're trying to split the data based on the gender, so we get 10 students in female category, 20 students in male category, but we have only 2 students or female plays cricket, whereas 13 boys plays cricket. And here we are splitting it based on the height. People who are like, you know, taller than 5.5 feet, sorry, shorter than 5.5 feet, we have like, you know, 5 students, and people are taller have 18 students. And we are like trying to split it based on the class 9 and 10. So we have 14 people on class 9 and 16 people in class 10. So here shows like, you know, 56% of the students in class 10, you know, they play cricket. So, but when you're trying to split, when you have a data of 30 students, when you have to like, you know, create a sub nodes, we really don't know on what criteria we can, you know, do the split. So that's where we're gonna like, you know, figure this out. There are like many methods available to do this. There are 4, we'll be discussing about only 4 methods through which, you know, this decision tree algorithms are like deciding to on splitting. Okay, the first one is, you know, based on Gini index. Okay, so this method is actually, you know, used when you have a categorical variable and when you have only 2 different outcomes. It can be either yes or no, failure or success, something like that. If you have like, you know, 3 different types of target variables, you can't go for Gini index. Okay, it can perform only binary splits. So when you have the value of this Gini coefficient kind of like above 0.8, 0.9, around 1, you can call that your data is homogeneous. Okay, so the value here, the range is from 0 to 1. Okay, so this Gini index actually is being used as a method to calculate the splits in CART function. Okay, so how do you like, you know, calculate Gini index? Okay, so here you have to like, you know, find the probability of success, which is P, and probability of a failure, which is Q, and then you square it up, the probabilities, and then you sum it up. Okay, log of success, occurrence of success square plus square of log of occurrence of failure, and then you sum it up. Okay, so then you find out a weighted Gini score for each of the node. Okay, so don't worry about this. I'll show you an example of how this is done for the previous example that we have discussed here. We discussed about this data, right? We'll be using the same data for all the 4 methods, and then we'll be calculating all the 4 parameters. Okay, so here you can see we're just like, you know, assuming that we will try to like check this out based on the gender. Okay, so we have 30 students, 15 people play cricket out of that. So we're trying to calculate the Gini index here for the split. So here 0.2, I mean, we have like only 2 female students who plays cricket. So 0.2 is a probability, 20%. So 0.2 into 0.2, I mean, we're squaring this up for the success. If you're like picking a random student out of this data subset, so the probability of getting a female who plays cricket is 0.2, and the failure is 0.8. I mean, you're picking a female who's like, who doesn't play cricket. It's 0.8. So here, the Gini index for this subnode female category is 0.68. When you do the same thing for male, it is 0.55. Okay, which means like, you know, more males play cricket. It's kind of little less. So when the calculated weighted Gini index for the split gender is like you have 10 females, so 10 by 30. Okay, so you should understand why we have this number here, 10 divided by 30 into 0.68 plus 20 boys out of 30 students multiplied by 0.5. So 0.59 is our weighted Gini index value for the gender split. And we are calculating the similar split for based on the classes, for class 9 and class 10. So we have 0.51 and 0.51 for both class 9 and 6. So obviously our weighted Gini index is also 0.51. So here, when you see, when you compare these two values, the Gini score for split on gender is kind of higher when compared to the class. So we have to go for the gender. Okay. So based on the Gini index values for each of the splits, we will be like, you know, going with the gender split. Okay, hope you got this. So this is how Gini index works. Okay, next we can use chi-square as well, you know. So for this you have to be using a method called CIDE or chi-square automatic interaction detector. Okay, so this also, like, you know, works for only categorical variable like your Gini index, but it can perform two or more splits. Okay, if you want to, like, you know, create 3-4 splits, you have to go for chi-square and not Gini index. Okay, so here we'll be, like, you know, calculating a chi-square for each of the individual node by calculating a deviation from success and failure, and then you would, like, you know, do the sum of all the success and failure for each of the node split, and then you get into the value. Okay, so I think you all know the value formula for chi-square, like it's actual value minus expected value, the whole square divided by square root of expected value. Okay, so we are using the same example. Okay, and then we are trying to identify the splits based on the chi-square. So here we have female, out of 15 female, only 2 people play cricket, 13 male play cricket. Okay, so people who don't play cricket is like, sorry, out of 10 females, 2 people play cricket. Okay, so the, here the total is 10 and 20, so we get 30 students. And actually, you know, the expected value is 5. Like, we have only like 10 people, so the expected value is 5 here. And for male, the expected value is 10. And the people who are not play cricket is also similar, because it's, I have a 50-50 chance, right? So here the deviation is minus 3. Since, like, you know, 3 people do not play cricket, here the deviation is minus 3 for playing cricket and plus 3 for playing cricket for men. And similarly, here the deviation is plus 3 for not playing cricket for female and minus 3 for not playing cricket for male. Okay, and then you compute your chi-square values, and then you get the values. I think you all know how to compute this, right? I showed you the formula here. It's actual minus expected whole squared by its expected square. Okay, so you're applying that formula, and then you're computing the chi-square values, and then you get a total chi-square. Okay, so it's just sum up. Okay, so similarly, you're doing a similar calculation for, based on the class 9 and 10. Here is the one, you're taking the node classes, here just the gender. So everything remains the same, but the numbers vary, right? You know, we have 6 people from 9 standard and 9 people from 10 standard, right? Who plays cricket? Okay, so similarly, we just like fill up the values and then we get a chi-square root of 1.46. So when you compare that, so we have, you know, we see this chi-square value is like kind of higher. So we found out the gender split is more significant when compared to the class fit. Okay, so we're getting a similar output as your Gini index. Okay, so next method is information gain. Okay, so it is actually, you know, it is calculated based on entropy. Okay, so entropy is nothing but a degree of disorganization in your data. Okay, so if all of your data is completely, you know, homogeneous, your entropy is zero because there is no disorganization. Everything looks perfect. If all your data as, you know, female students who does not play cricket, your entropy is zero. Like you can't just divide this, right? You have data of female who never plays cricket. So entropy is zero. But if you have, you know, a sample which is like equally divided, a balanced data with 50-50% chance, you have entropy as one. Okay. So always, like, you know, when compared to the previous things as well. So here the value range lies between 0 to 1. So the entropy formula here is like, you know, minus p multiplied by log of p minus q multiplied by log of q. It's nothing but your probability, p and q is the probability of success and failure. When you pick a random item from your sample, if the probability of getting success is p, the probability of getting failure is q. Okay, so information gain is calculated by 1 minus entropy. Okay. So you so information gain is actually completely based on entropy. Entropy is nothing but your degree of disorganization in a system. Okay. So first, how do you calculate entropy for a split? First, you have to, like, you know, calculate the entropy for your parent nodes, and then you work on each of the individual node based on the splits, and then you take up a weighted average. Similar thing. So using the same example as before, first we're calculating the entropy for a parent node. Okay, so 15 people plays cricket out of 30 students. So minus p multiplied by log of p. Okay, 15 divided by 30. So minus picking a person who's not playing cricket is also, like, you know, it's chance is 15 by 30, right? So same thing. So we are getting the entropy as 1. It's completely impure. We don't have a pure node at all. Okay. So we are going with the female node here. We're just splitting up for the female node. So we have 2 females out of 10. So 2 by 10 log 2. Sorry, log of 2 by 10 minus 8 into log of 8 by 10. I mean, here females were playing cricket, females who did not play cricket. So here the entropy is 0.72, and for the male node it is 0.93. Okay. You hope you got this. Okay. So, and then we are calculating the entropy for split for gender completely. So you have to, like, you know, take a weighted entropy for all the subnodes, female and male. So female we have 10 divided by 30. I mean, probability of having a female multiplied by entropy of a female node 0.72 plus probability of having a male multiplied by 0.93, which is your male node's entropy. So we get 0.86. Okay. So we are just doing a calculation based on the entropy formula here, and then we have a entropy calculated for class 9 node, class 10 node, and then you are doing a weighted entropy for the subnode class, and then here it is 0.99. Okay, so here the split for gender is kind of less when compared to the class. So we'll be, like, you know, going with the gender because, you know, we have to like go for lesser entropy, which means because we have to like get the information gain by using the formula 1 minus entropy. So here 0.14 is our information gain. So here it is 0.01 for a class. So we have to go with the higher information gain or lower entropy. Okay. Hope you understood entropy and information gain concepts. Next one is reduction in variance. Okay. So this is actually a method which can be used for regression trees. Okay. Earlier we have been discussing about the methods for the classification trees. Okay. So here we have to calculate the variance, and then we have to go with the split with lower variance. Okay. So far we have been going with the split with higher gain index and higher information gain and higher chi-square value. But here it is not the case. You have to go with the split with the lower variance. Okay, so here we have to calculate the variance for each node, and then you have to take up a weighted average for all of your split nodes to calculate your node variance. Okay, so here we'll be using the formula summation of x minus x bar the whole square divided by n, as n is your number of variables or tuples, and we have x value and x bar is a mean. Okay, so we'll be assigning a numerical value of 1 for playing cricket and 0 for not playing cricket. Okay, so and then we'll be calculating the variance for the root node and female and male node, and then we'll be calculating for the complete variance for the split. Okay, so here the mean value is 15. We have 15 people who plays cricket and 15 people who do not. So for playing cricket it's 1, right? So 15 multiplied by 1 plus 15 multiplied 0 divided by 30. So we get the mean value 0.5. Okay, so here the variance should be x minus x bar whole square divided by n. So x minus x bar is 0.5. So 1 minus 0.5 the whole square, it goes on until 15 times, because all the values who are playing cricket, it's 1. See, actually we are substituting. Yeah, we are doing encoding. We have categorical variables. That's why we are assigning 0 and 1. Hope you got this already. Okay. And then we have zeros for people who are not playing cricket. So 0 minus 0.5 whole square. It goes on until 15 times. And all these things divided by 30. Okay. So actually you can write this as 15 multiplied by 1 minus 0.5 the whole square plus 15 multiplied by 0 minus 0.5 the whole square. So the answer is 0.25. So the variance for the root node is 0.25. So mean of female node is, we have two, we'll be just using this method. So 2 female who plays cricket, so 2 into 1, 8 female who don't play cricket, so 8 multiplied by 0. So we get 2 divided by 10, which is 0.2. Okay, and then this is the mean, and we calculate the variance. We'll be substituting the same values as in here. Okay. The mean of female node is 0.16. The mean of male node, we calculate based on the same thing. Sorry, mean of female node is 0.2. Variance of the female node is 0.16. Based on the same method, we'll be calculating the mean of male node, 0.65. Variance of the male node, 0.23. Okay. And then we have to do a weighted variance for this subnodes male and female. Okay. So we have for females 10 divided by 30 multiplied by the variance of the female node 0.16 plus 20 divided by 30 multiplied by the variance of the male node 0.23. So we get 0.21. Okay, the similar way we'll be doing calculations for calculating mean of class 9 and variance of class 9, mean of class 10, variance of class 10, and then we'll be calculating variance for the whole split for gender. We get 0.25. So now we'll be like comparing the variance for the split gender and class. Okay. Sorry, here it's variance for split class, not gender. I'm sorry about this. Okay, so now we can see the variance for the split gender is lesser. So earlier I told we have to pick the variance, lesser variance, because method is reduction in variance, right? In all of the previous methods, we'll be going for the higher values in the parameters, but here we have to pick out the lesser value. So we have to go with the gender split. So for all the methods, we are getting an answer of going with the gender split. Even we adopted regression trees by substituting 0 and 1. 1 for playing cricket and 0 for not playing cricket. Okay. So these are the four methods that we have been discussing that can be used to decide how to split your nodes. Okay. So you can adopt any of the methods, and based on the conditions, based on the problem, the data problem, you can just go with this any of the methods. Okay, but we usually face a lot of problems while working on this kind of complex data. So for that, when you carefully trying to get a good accuracy, you will end up with a lot of overfitting problems. Okay, so for that, you have to work on two different methods. You can work on two different methods so that you can avoid overfitting. First one is you can set constraints in your algorithm. Okay, so on how you want to have your tree, so you can just mention how many samples that each node should have. And you can also mention how many minimum samples that all your leaf node, the last node, should have. So if you're trying to get a minimum of 20 nodes, 20 samples in each of the nodes, obviously the split is going to be decreased. Instead of otherwise it will, the split will be happening until the nodes will have at least minimum of one node, one with sample. Otherwise, you can just give the maximum, what should be the maximum depth of the tree. Okay, or you can just limit it with maximum number of terminal nodes that you can have in a tree. And you can also check on what are the features which are important on based on that you should have a split. So you can just identify the right features. You can just do feature importance, and then you can just mention the important features here for the split. That also can be done. So when you work on real life through coding, I think you'll be able to understand this. I'll show you a sample snippet of the code as well, so that you understand how to set a constraint. Okay, so that you can tune your parameters. Otherwise, you can go with tree pruning method as well. But it's kind of a little greedy approach. You don't have to go for this always. But most of people try to understand how the complete decision tree looks like, so that it goes to the complete depth of it. Okay, and then they start removing it by removing each of the nodes. Okay, so it gives you complete understanding of your data. It's really a costly method, as it is a greedy approach. Okay, so now you have to really work on bias and variance. Okay, so hopefully, I believe that you already know this concept, but still I'm kind of reiterating this so that you don't have to struggle when you're talking about ensembling learning. Okay, so bias is actually calculated based on the difference between your predicted value and the expected value. Okay, and variance is calculated based on the difference between the average of the predicted values with the difference with the predicted value mean. Okay, so usually the error in the model is calculated by summation of variance of the variance, bias and the noise, which is kind of like, you know, you can't figure that out usually. So when you have a model which is completely underfitting, you will be having a, you know, a picture similar to this, a graph similar to this, because you might be getting a linear model whereas your data is completely looks different. And overfitting looks like this, but this desired model should, like, you know, should look like this. Okay.
So on which data it is being plotted, ma'am? Like
this one.
Yeah, like dots.
No, this is just a sample one. I'm just showing an example of how underfitting and overfitting looks like.
Yeah, ma'am, I could understand, but I just want to know what are these dots and then lines, ma'am.
Okay. So here, this is your predicted values and this is your actual dots are the actual values and line is your predicted value.
Okay.
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 Okay. So actual values or the dots, because we are like trying to like fit a model for the dots. So that's why it is showing overfitting here. Okay. So when you plot, you know, bias and variance here. So when you have a model with low bias and low variance, this is how it looks like. You know, because you know that you have to have a model with low bias and low variance, right? So this is how it looks like, a model with low bias but higher variance. It is bias, I mean, you have data concentrated around the center, but you know it has a lot of variance. It is not like together. When you have low variance, you have kind of totally deviated from your mean, but still the bias is higher. That's why it is like, you know, you're deviated, but it's all clustered together. When you have high bias and variance, it's completely, you know, useless. Okay, so when you, like, you know, have to have a good model complexity, complexity of the model increases, your bias decreases, yes, but you know, your variance kind of keep on increasing. So to have a optimum model, you have to, like, you know, try to lower your bias as well as, you know, you have to lower your variance. Sometimes, you know, people try to build a small tree, but they'll get a higher variance. Sorry, higher bias and lower variance. When they try to increase the model complexity, they'd be able to, like, you know, decrease their bias, but you know the variance will increase. Okay, so we always have to, like, you know, try to you know, bring in the optimal level so that, you know, your model is not underfitting as well as overfitting. Okay, so that's what you have to, like, you know, tune your parameters accordingly. Okay. So next concept is ensembling methods. So this is kind of like a little deviated from your decision tree concepts, but it's part of that. And you know, a lot of other algorithms like random forest, XGBoost, everything, like, you know, works based on ensemble methods. So when you say ensemble, it means group. Okay. So these methods actually help all the machine learning algorithms to, like, work better so that you can able to, like, you know, get good accuracy, lower bias, lower variance, so that you'll have a stable model. Okay, so there's a lot of various ensembling methods are available. Okay, but we'll be, like, you know, talking mostly about bagging and boosting. Okay, because these are majorly used in sampling methods, and we'll be concentrating on bagging because we'll be like, you know, studying about random forest, and random forest is completely based on bagging. Okay, so boosting is completely based on, extreme boost is, and double boosting is completely based on boosting method. Okay, so first we'll try to understand what is the difference between bagging and boosting. So when you in bagging, you'll be able to able to reduce your variance only, whereas in boosting methodologies, you'll be able to like reduce both your variance and bias. Okay, so in bagging methods, we'll be using only average techniques for prediction methods, whereas in boosting, we'll be using weighted average method. This is one of the major difference. So for bagging methodology, what we do is first we'll be creating multiple data set with replacement. Okay, so we'll be creating multiple subsets with replacements, and then we'll be building multiple classifiers on top of that data. So we'll be building different machine learning models on top of the subsets, okay, based on decision trees. And then you combine all this models, and then we do our average, and then you come up with the one algorithm. Okay, so this is a bagging methodology. Okay, I've described all these things here. First, you have to create multiple data sets with replacement from your data, and then you'll be taking a part of it, which includes both your tuples and variables as well. Okay, and then you build a model on top of each of the sample data set, and then you you'll be doing predictions, and then you combine all of your models using a mean, median, or bound based on the problem that you have, and then you create a single model. Okay. Boosting is kind of little different in compared to bagging. Here, what happens is it is actually it does not happen simultaneously. Whereas bagging happens simultaneously, or different samples are created, and then an algorithm is computed, and then it is combined. Whereas here in boosting, a subset is taken out, and then a model is trying to predict the data, and based on the previous based on the model that is created, they'll be applying the learnings of that particular model in the next process. Okay, so the succeeding model will be completely dependent on the previous model that is created. Okay, so it will be able to combine a lot of weak learners so to form a strong learner. Okay, so earlier it is a simultaneous process, the bagging, whereas boosting is a sequential process, so that you'll be able to have better results when compared to bagging. Okay, so here when you see the similarities, bagging and boosting, it actually create different subsets and then create a model on top of that, and then be able to until that it's same, but here it is happening sequentially, whereas in boosting it is happening simultaneously. And in boosting, they actually work on the misclassified subsets again and again, so that it is able to create a good model, so that we'll be having a good prediction. So whereas we don't have a chance of identifying what is a misclassified subset at all in bagging. Okay. In weighted average, bagging, weighted average will be used, whereas here we'll be using a weighted voting method. Okay, it is completely based on the model, iteration model. Okay, a simple snippet of the code for bagging and boosting in Python. Okay, so here you're using the bagging classifier, you're using a ADAboost classifier. Okay, and the criteria is entropy for both. But here, so I'm just identifying, trying to say max depth is none, just equal. So here, don't worry about it. So here I'm using bagging classifier, you're using a ADAboost classifier. That's the real difference. Okay. Okay. So next, we'll get into random forest. So as decision trees, random forest is also like, you know, able to like, you know, work on regression classification problems. It is actually based on ensemble learning method bagging, as I told you before. Okay. So here, as I told you, a random subset is created with replacement, and then we'll be like, you know, trying to like create a model on top of it, but we have to like identify the number of variables in each of the subset should be less than the original data. So the input variables in your data is capital M, and each node having the variables is M. A small m. So small m should be lesser than the capital M. So that has to be like, you know, taken care. And then, so each tree on each of the subset is like, you know, kind of grown until the end. And then, you know, we will not be like pruning here. So we'll be just growing the whole trees. And then we'll be like, you know, doing a summation of all these trees. Okay. And then we'll be able to like identify the model. This is completely based on bagging. Okay. So hope you're able to like understand how this works. Okay, so far we like, you know, we discussed lot of important concepts. Like what is a decision tree, what are the types of trees, and how you can like, you know, split your data using tree-based algorithm. So I discussed about four parameters like Gini index and chi-square, information gain, which is based on entropy, and reduction in variance. And then we discussed about how we can avoid overfitting, and then how you can like create a trade-off between bias and variance. And then we discussed about ensembling methods, and then boosting and bagging. And then we discussed how random forest works. Okay. So hope you had a good understanding on this. If you got any doubts, you can ask me now.